No weapon they throw at me, you know it won't prosper. Now,
yeah, just got laid off.
I'm doing good.
House ain't even paid off.
I'm doing good.
Should be afraid, but
I'm feeling good.
All the time you say,
God is good. Come on. Down, down, down. Don't forget who's in control. Walls are falling down, down, down.
They call it down.
Get ready for the new Jericho. You're waiting on God. He's waiting on you.
So what you gonna do?
Hey, yo, 1, 2, 3. Get up, we got victory. No weapon they throw at me,
it won't.
You know it won't prosper now.
God, this is crazy.
Hey, yo, 1, 2, 3. Get up, we got victory. No weapon they throw at me, you know it won't prosper now. Storm's raging.
I'm doing good.
You see the world changing.
I'm doing good.
I know.
God is good.
Doing good.
See
the world.
is good.
God is good.
Come down, down, down. Don't forget who's in control. Walls are falling down, down, down.
Get ready.
Get ready for the new Jericho. You're waiting on God.
You're waiting on God.
He's waiting on you.
He's waiting on you.
With all you've been through, now it's on you. So what you gonna do?
Come on.
Hey, y'all, 1, 2, 3. Get up, we got victory.
Yes, sir.
Go up and make grow at me. You know it won't prosper now.
Sing.
Hey, y'all, 1, 2, 3. Get up, we got victory. Go up and make grow at me. You know it won't prosper now.
Church.
The battle's not yours. It is the Lord.
You keep trying. Scars, but we're still winning. Sing the anthem.
Hey, yo, 1, 2, 3. Get up, we got victory. No weapon may grow at me.
It won't.
You know it won't prosper now.
1, 2, 3.
Hey, yo, 1, 2, 3.
Yeah.
Get up, we got victory.
See them hands up.
No weapon may grow
no
at
weapon
me.
Formed against
you. Know you. It won't prosper.
Won't prosper.
Now.
And all my people say,
I'm doing good.
See, the reason why you're doing good,
doing good
is because what's ahead of you is greater than
good.
All the things that were behind you. And see, you gotta
I'm
understand. You gotta understand that everything was already ordained before you
good.
Got here for you to do good.
I'm
see, eyes
good.
Have not seen, ears have not heard, neither has it entered into the heart. God's masterful plan for his children.
I'm
and that's
good.
Who you are, baby girl. You God's child. My brother, that's who you are. You gotta understand that all things are working for you.
Good.
Good. That's love.
Amen. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Our feet have been standing within thy gates, O Jerusalem. Good morning. Welcome to the New Bethel African Methodist Episcopal Church. And this is our Youth Sunday. This is Sunday, July 11th. And our youth are going to be on display today. And boy, we're going to have us a good time in the name of the Lord. Just a couple of reminders. Let me first of all thank all of the parents. You have done marvelously well making sure our children were in place. They'll be doing the prayers, the songs, the scriptures, and everything else this morning. Secondly, let me remind you that we still need to wear our masks. Let me remind you there's a new variant, the Delta variant of the COVID-19, which is even more deadly than the original COVID-19. So I'm reminding you to please get your vaccinations, your inoculations, and let's be safe and let's live. Because Jesus said, I came to bring life, and not only life, but life more abundantly. Amen. Thirdly, let me remind you about Bible study. It's getting good in Bible study this week. We're going to have Mark chapter 2, and I believe we're coming up on the scribes and the Pharisees on this week. So we got a good report coming up, and we're going to have a wonderful conversation to help you in your life as God has presented it to you. Amen. We're going to help you discover your purpose as you go through the process. Amen. Then, of course, on next Sunday is our Celebration Sunday. We're going to start today off, Navi Lettenhand is going to be doing our prayer this morning for us. And then our choir will come, our youth choir, and they're going to be singing, Everybody Clap Your Hands. Everybody Clap. Amen. We'll go to that right now.
Kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Hallelujah. Everybody clap your hands. Amen. 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 Everybody clap your hands. Thank you, Navi Lettenham, and thank you for your grandmother as well, Sister Betty. And also, let me thank our marvelous praise team, our youth choir, and all the parents that were involved. Destiny Robbins, Tiani Clarity, Tara Hurchins, Aiden Shins, and let's see who else we had. Sapphire Hagans. Hey, we had Rihanna Adams. I didn't realize we had a big star with us. And then Ava Hurchins, thank you so much, and thank you to all of our parents. We're still having a good time in the name of the Lord. We're going to ask you now if you will get your tithe and offering. That is the portion of the worship service. We want to worship God by honoring God with the first fruits of all of our increase. Amen. All right. And you know, I have gone totally digital with my tithe and offering. It's so easy for me to do that through Givelify now. And if you haven't gotten there through Givelify or Cash App, they're going to put those on the screen for you now. And all of you who are still old school like I used to be, thank you for dropping your tithe off by the church or to your class leaders. And for now, the Givelify app is New Bethel AME Quincy. And I think the Cash App will be the same thing, New Bethel AME Quincy, Florida. Amen. And then if you're mailing it in, and thank all of you who are so diligent about mailing your tithe and your offering in, that would be Post Office Box 634 here in beautiful downtown Quincy, Florida. And we take a moment now to pray over your gifts. And God, we thank you so much for blessing us and keeping us in such marvelous and powerful ways. Even amidst a prolonged pandemic, you have proven yourself to be powerful and mighty and still a God that's in control and on the throne. Lord God, we give thee but thine own, and of thine own we give back to you. Lord God, let these tithes, let these offerings go towards the building of your kingdom of heaven right here on earth. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right. I believe at this point we're going to have our scripture reading, and I believe we're going to have another song. That song is going to be Say Yes. Amen. And I believe that Tara Hurchins will be doing our scripture reading for this morning. So keep tuning in. Amen. It just gets better and better.
Today I will be reading Mark 6, chapter 14th through 19th verse. Herod Antipas, the king, soon heard about Jesus because everyone was talking about him. Some were saying, "This must be John the Baptist raised from the dead. That's why he can do such miracles." Others say he is the prophet Elijah. Still others say he is the prophet like the other great prophets of the past. When Herod heard about Jesus, he said, "John, the man I beheaded, has come back from the dead." For Herod had sent soldiers to arrest and imprison John as a favor to Herodias. Herodias, she had been his brother Philip's wife, but Herod had married her. John had been telling Herod, "It's against God's law for you to marry your brother's wife." So Herodias bore a grudge against John and wanted to kill him. But without Herod's approval, she was powerless. The word of God for the people of God.
Thank you. the time? What time?
Hallelujah. When Jesus says yes, nobody. Amen. I love those children. Amen. Once again, little Tiani Clarity. We had Rihanna. Amen. Rihanna Adams, Sapphire. We had Miss New Bethel, Destiny, Destiny Robbins. And then we had Ada, Ava, and Tara Hurchins. Amen. Oh, and little Navi Lettenhand. Amen. I think I covered everybody on that one. And then once again, let me thank all the parents. At this point, I would like to just share a few. I want to pray. And so Sister Thelma Wills was rushed to the hospital today. She's in room 305 at Capital Regional Medical Center. But we've also had some deaths of members in our church family, and I just wanted to lift them up this morning. So if you will, and I see Sister Deandra Moore on the line, and we've been praying fervently for you, Deandra, and especially for your mom. I mentioned deaths in our church family and people in our circle of church family members. Sister Mildred McClendon died up in Syracuse, New York. That's Brother Wallace's night sister. Tina Dershell Jackson Moore Baker, she's had two deaths back to back in her family. She just buried her aunt, Sister Cora Jackson Moulton, on yesterday. And then her fiance, Brother Victor Sweet, has died as well. And then, of course, Deandra is her daughter. So let's have a word of prayer. God, we pray right now in the mighty and awesome and powerful name of Jesus that you will bless us to be a blessing. Right now, Lord God, we want to lift up the sick, the poor, the disheartened. We want to pray for those on intercessory prayer lists, those that are on hospital beds and sick rooms, nursing homes and hospices. We want to pray right now, Lord God, for those who are jailbound and on lockdown. We pray for our leaders, Lord God, internationally, nationally, statewide, and locally. And we want to pray right now in Jesus' name that you prove yourself mighty in a mighty and awesome way. We also, Lord God, in addition to the Moulton family and the Sweet family and the McClendon family, we want to lift up Julius Fisher's family, a great man of God, great man in this community. We'll right now in Jesus' name that you will grant all of these families peace to surpass understanding, to guard their hearts and their minds in Christ Jesus. We pray right now in Jesus' name, Lord God, lifting up Sister Kaya Miller and Sister Terrellyn George. We want to pray for Barbara Baker and Adrian Kelly. Lift up Sister Letheria Peters. Sister Lizzie Figures. We want to pray for Sister Alfonia Bowie Wilson. We pray for our entire church family and all of their family members extended. We pray right now in the mighty and powerful name of Jesus that you will empower us to be the head and not the tail, to be above and not beneath, to be a lender and not a borrower, and so that our latter days might be greater than our former days. It's in Jesus' name we pray, hallelujah, and amen. Amen. Let the church say amen. Amen. All right. Let me briefly introduce our preacher. He feels like a part of the family, at least to me. and he's always willing and able to come, and he always brings a timely word, and we expect no less now. He's just getting back from Orlando, Florida, which is actually his hometown. And we were down there together at the General Conference. Amen. I didn't make this a part of my announcement, but our brand new bishop, and I know Sister Joanne Kimball will be glad to hear this, our brand new bishop is going to be Bishop Frank Madison Reed. Amen. A lot of you probably remember him from Bethel AME Church in Baltimore, Maryland, where he won bishop several years ago. He will be our new bishop for at least the next 3 years. Amen. So we welcome him with open arms. All right. And then our bishop, Bishop Adam Jefferson Richardson, he's off to the great state of Texas now. He'll be out there until his retirement in 3 years as well. All right, having said all of that, Marvin Bouquet has been with us before. We just anticipate a mighty word of God from him this morning, fresh back from Orlando, Florida, and the General Conference. Amen. I believe that would be, before he comes up, we'll have yet another song from our marvelous praise team, and I believe that that song is going to be I Belong to You. Amen. Listen for the word of God and Marvin Bouquet right after I Belong to You.
God said, amen. This is the day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. I am so glad to be alive one more time, giving honor to God, who is the head of my life. And I'm so very grateful for your wonderful pastor, the Reverend Charles Morris. I, I really do believe that I belong to this church. I think I'm a part of this church. I don't know how many times, Reverend Morris, I've been here, but I claim New Bethel as my church too as well. To the New Bethel members, God bless you. And I bring you greetings from New Mount Zion AME Church, under the moniker of the City of the Great King, where the Reverend Dr. Anton G. Wood is pastor. Let us go to God in prayer. Wonderful God, in Jesus' name, I am standing here, God. Lord, decrease me and you stand. Lord, just let me be your microphone in Jesus' name, O God. Forgive me of my sins, whether by thought, word, deed, against your divine majesty. In Jesus' name, amen. If you have your Bibles, would you journey with me to the Gospel according to Luke, the 7th chapter, beginning at the 11th verse. The Gospel according to Luke, the 7th chapter, beginning at the 11th verse. It is my custom to read from the New International Version of the Bible. Follow along with your version. Listen to the words of the Lord. Soon afterward, Jesus went to a town called Nain, and his disciples and a large crowd went along with him. As he approached the town gate, a dead person was being carried out, the only son of his mother. And as she was a widow, and a large crowd from the town was with her. When the Lord saw her, his heart went out to her, and he said, "Don't cry." Then he went up and touched the bier they were carrying him on, and the bearer stood still. He said, "Young man, I say to you, get up." The dead man sat up and began to talk, and Jesus gave him back to his mother. They were all filled with awe and praised God. "A great prophet has appeared among us," they said. "God has come to help his people." This news about Jesus spread throughout Judea and the surrounding country. The word of God for the people of God, and the people of God said, "Thanks be to God." For the few moments that are mine, I want to tag this text, "Dead on arrival." Dead on arrival. Brothers and sisters in Christ, the term "dead on arrival" is something that we hear in the medical field, something that we've heard on television, something that we've heard even in reports. The dictionary defines "dead on arrival" to be a person who is declared dead immediately upon arrival at a hospital. And then there's another definition that says "dead on arrival" is declared ineffective without ever having been put into effect. Brothers and sisters, I'm sure that you can attest that there are some situations in your life, there are things in your life that you would declare dead on arrival. What we understand is that death is something that we in the natural realm would consider final. If it is dead, it can no longer move again. If it is dead, it can no longer change. When death happens to human being, we know the natural stages of death. What happens is rigor mortis sets in, where the body becomes stiff and no longer can be moved easily. Or death causes dead weight, where things become too heavy because it is still. And anything still for too long does not help the situation. Water, when water is not moving and it's still, it infected with things. When it's still, it has bacteria that begins to grow because it's been still too long. Is there anything life that you've ever felt like has been dead on arrival? What do you do when you're going through something and Jesus is not there to help you
and the situation that was close to you, the thing that was close to you, the person that was close to you is suddenly dead on arrival. This is a familiar text in the Bible where there's a woman who has a son and she's a widow. And we understand in biblical times when you were a widow and you were a woman and you were a widow because your husband is what identified you, and you were no longer a person with a voice because your husband was dead. And typically when your husband was dead, there was no financial increase, because usually that was the individual that handled the finances and worked while you stayed home. So yet this woman, we can infer, number one, she is a widow and she's low on money, and then the child that she has died. Her son, her baby boy is dead. She loses her husband, and then she loses her son. Have you ever been in a situation where one thing was already bad and suddenly something else happened? What do you do when you're already worried about one thing and going through one storm, and then another storm comes behind it? What do you do when you ask God to make a way, and while you're in the midst of praying to God, God, do it for me, something else happens? What happens when pressure is on one side and suddenly when you turn to the right, pressure is on the other side? What do you do when pressure is to the north and pressure is to the back? What do you do when pressure is on top and pressure is on the bottom? But I came to let you know, just to remind you, you're just like the olive, for the Bible says it's pressed. And when anything from the olive is pressed, it produces oil. And every now and then, the reason why you have pressure in the first place is because God is trying to get the oil. You know, it's hard for us as individuals because we're going through what we're going through, and sometimes we cannot see light at the end of the tunnel because of pressure. But pressure ain't always that bad. Sometimes you have to go through some stuff in order to know who God is. What do you mean, Marvin? You won't know that God is a provider unless you've been in a place where you needed God to provide. In order for you to understand Jehovah Jireh is, you have to be in a place where you need God to show up and put a ram in the bush for you. In order for you to know that he's a healer, sometimes there are some folk that have to go to the hospital to understand that God is a healer. We as Christians expect things to just be perfect. God cannot be God and show up in your life unless some things happen to you. That's tough theology for us, because as Christians, sometimes we expect life to be just perfect and life to just go our way and the things to just happen the way we expect them to happen. But we serve a God who does things unconventionally. We serve a God that he does things in his order. What happens is we think that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, A, B, C, D, E, F, G is the order of God. Not identify what order is, because the one who created order is God. So if God wants to put Z first and then God wants to put B first, he can do that because God created order. So sometimes we want to use our own intellect, our own mindset, our own thoughts to try to figure out how God's going to do it. But God is the one who created thinking, so you cannot outthink God. So what you have to do is stop worrying about how God's going to do it and just know that God is going to do it. Here's I like this text because this text shows us how Jesus is so unconventional. It was Jewish custom that you could not touch the dead body or even touch what the dead body was on. In other words, those who actually were holding the dead body were considered unclean, so they were allowed to touch because they were unclean. In other words, that once you touch the body or touch whatever the body was touching, you were now placed in a category of unclean. So, and what happens is Jesus hears and recognizes that there is a woman who is suffering. Watch this. If you're taking notes, write this down. Jesus cares about your feelings. Jesus cares about your feelings. Those that are on Facebook and YouTube, I need you to type Jesus cares about about your feelings. The Bible says when the Lord saw her, his heart went out to her and he said, don't cry. The Bible says that when Jesus saw her, the Lord, his heart went out to her, said, don't cry. That Jesus was so concerned about how she felt, what she was dealing with, what she was going through, that Jesus saw her and spoke directly to her. There's something about Jesus is that when you're going through something, that Jesus will speak directly to you. He will speak directly to you. He is not going to go over and out. But when God, when Jesus sees that you're going through something, he will minister to you and speak to the very thing that's happening to you and tell you, don't. He'll tell you, don't worry. He'll tell you, do not be afraid. It's something about the Jesus that we serve that he cares about your feelings. Jesus cares about your feelings. He recognizes that she's crying, and he speaks to her and says, don't cry. But what's amazing is not only that when Jesus cares about your feelings and he recognizes what's going on with you, because there are some people in your life that they'll see that you're sad, they'll see that you're depressed, they'll see that you're worried, they'll see that you're overwhelmed, and they'll say, don't cry, don't worry, don't be overwhelmed, and that is the end of the conversation. But what Jesus does is, after he tells her, don't cry, the Bible says, then he went up and touched the bear. Ah, God have mercy. Every now and then, the type of God that we serve, he's not going to only speak to it, he's also going to do something about it. He's not only going to tell you not to cry, he's not only going to tell you not to worry, but not only does he handle and he's concerned about your very feelings, then Jesus is going to automatically decide to go and fix what you're dealing with. He says, "Cry," and the Bible says, then he went up and touched the bear that was carrying the dead body. Watch this, watch this. Watch this. Jesus loves you enough that he would break every custom and law just to make sure that you come out on top. What do you mean? I told you in the beginning of the sermon that Jesus, it was Jewish custom not to touch the dead body. It was Jewish custom not to touch whatever the dead body was touching. It was Jewish custom not even to touch people that was touching the dead body. So what Jesus recognizes was that this is my daughter who's dealing with something, who's going through something, who's in the midst of the storm. I don't care what the political parties say. I don't care what customs say. I don't care what the government says. I don't care what the people say. But when I know that my child is going through something, I'm going to make sure that I care about their feelings, and I'm going to make sure that I do something to make sure they come out on time. Watch, watch, watch this, watch this, watch this. The Bible says that he saw that she was crying and told her not to cry, and then the Bible says as soon as he told her don't cry, then he went up and touched what shouldn't have touched. But what's amazing is we understand in the biblical text something about the touch of Jesus that changes all kinds of stuff. It's sometimes it's Jesus touching them, and sometimes it's them touching Jesus. Because I've recognized is as long as you can get a touch from God, everything that you've been going through will be all right. What do you mean, Marvin? Look at the woman with the issue of blood. She was just trying to get to Jesus, and she didn't even get to his hand. She didn't get to his head. She didn't get to his arm. She just touched to him. And the Bible says virtue came out of Jesus. And all of a sudden, suddenly what she was going through was she was healed. Jesus concerned, number one, he's concerned about how you feel. And number two, not only is he concerned about how you feel, he's getting ready to do something to handle, to making you feel the way that you feel. What I want you to realize is that I think what we do with our very educated self, very smart self, we have degrees and master's degrees and PhDs, and we have MDivs and DMins, and we have all types of degrees, and we have gone to Harvard and Yale, and we've gone to Florida A&M University, and we've gone to FSU and UCF, and we've gone to Howard, and we've gone to FMU, we've gone to all of these universities and institutions of higher learning, and we've been in places, and we are executives at our jobs, and we are our chiefs, and we are lawyers and attorneys and judges, and we are doctors. And what happens is our intellect can be the very thing that blocks us from our very blessing. What do you mean, Marvin? What happens is what we're trying to do is we are people who are trying to figure out how it's going to get done, and we're trying to understand how God's going to do it, and we literally try to think it through the way God is going to bless or heal or deliver us. And if in our minds we say that it cannot be done, then we get to a place where we no longer believe God can do it, because our intellect, our brain, our mind is saying that it cannot be done. But I came to let somebody know at New Bethel, don't put God in a box. And if you are taking notes, write this down. Don't put God in a box. If you're watching on Facebook and YouTube, type it. Don't put God in a box. Don't put God in a box. What happens is we are trying to constrain what God can do for us. We are trying to make sure that God will do it in a certain way. But the text shows us that Jesus does something that he should not have done, and the people were not expecting for Jesus to touch what was considered unclean. Because the law and the custom was that Jesus should not touch this. And what happens is, I believe mentally, this woman and the people around was thinking, well, he's dead now. We're getting ready to go and put him in the ground. Because once death happens, we think that it is over. And what I realize is that death never final with Jesus Christ. Death has never been final with Jesus Christ. There are stories and there are biblical texts that shows us that just because Lazarus is dead does not mean that it's final. Just because this boy is dead does not mean that it is final. And what I want to leave in your spirit today is that you cannot use your mind to hinder the move of God. Your mind can be your jail cell, because if your mind is saying that it cannot be done, then suddenly you believe that God cannot do it. But Jesus us that all he has to do is just touch. He doesn't even have to touch the body. I'm going to just touch what was by it. I'm going to do it so different that it's going to confuse everybody. It's going to be out of order. It's going to be a way that you didn't expect it. So I don't know what you're dealing with. I don't know the storm that you're in, and you're expecting Jesus to come from the right door, but he's getting ready to come from the left door. You're expecting Jesus to show up right now. He's going to wait until it's over to show you that I do things after the fact, because it doesn't matter what they say, because as soon as I speak, whatever they say is now null and void. See, what happens is we get real tired and weary and sad and depressed and worried because it didn't work out the way that we wanted it to work out. And it's just like how they were like when Lazarus was dead. Well, they said, Jesus, if you would have showed up a few days ago, it would have been better. But no, it does not matter when Jesus shows up. Because it's all already done. I need to hasten and get out of the way. What's good is the Bible says that the dead man sat up when Jesus said, young man, I say to you, get up. Here's what I want to leave you with, is that when Jesus is getting ready to turn your thing around, he's going to tell you to do something that you cannot do. What do you mean? Bible says the dead man sat up because Jesus called him and said, get up. What happens is again, your mind is very important on your miracle and your blessing. If your mind would not align with what is happening in the supernatural realm, then you would not be able to the command of Jesus. Jesus tells the man to get up because he needs to get up, but he's dead. But what happens is, if the mama was like, well, Jesus, why are you going to tell him to get up? He's already dead. That is some type of negativity. But sometimes it will be so unorthodox, so different, so it will move in a way that you don't expect it to move, that when Jesus comes, he's going to tell you to get up. And I don't know what your storm is. I don't know what your problem is, but Jesus is getting ready to tell you to get up. And when Jesus tells you to get up, you need to stop and show him that you are alive and well, that you are alive and well. So Jesus tells him to get up, and he gets up, and the Bible says, and he began to talk, and Jesus gave him back to his mother. I don't know what he was saying, but in my own spiritual imagination, I can imagine when you've been dead, locked up, tied up all along, and rigor mortis has set in, and you are no longer in your right mind, and suddenly the wind of God comes to you and gets you back up. I believe this child would begin to say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I can breathe again. Thank you, Jesus. I'm moving again. Thank you, Jesus, for making a way. So every now and then, when Jesus comes to you and tells you to get up, you ought to have a praise on your lip to say, God, I thank you. I thought it was over. God, I thank you. I thought I lost my mind. God, I thank you. I thought it wouldn't happen for me. I'm done. I got to get out of here. And the text says that Jesus then gives him back to his mother. And the Bible says they were filled with awe and praised God. Every time God does something in your life that blows your mind, it is a moment for you to give God your best praise. It's a moment for you to lift up your hands and tell God, thank you. It's a moment for you to praise and worship God, because this is one of those things that it had to be God. Is there anybody in the house, anybody at home that has it had to be God moment? There is something that's getting ready to happen to you this week, and your response will be, it had to be God. When someone says, how did it happen to you? It had to be God. That will be your response this week. When they're worried about how it's going to happen and God turns it around, your response should be, it had to be God. It had to be God that opened up the doors. It had to be God that healed you. It had to be God that blessed you. It had to be God that made a way. It had to be God that blessed you. It happened to be God that healed you of cancer. It had to be God that when they said you're going to die, they brought you back. It had to. And there's something about it, when God does it, then nobody else can take credit for it. It had to be God. I got to get out of here. I got to get out of here. That Jesus cares about you. And not only does he care about you, but Jesus is going to fix whatever has you feeling the way that you feel. Now, here we are. Here we are, dead on arrival, where your thing comes and it's dead. I don't know the people who are listening to me right now on the internet, who's listening to me on Facebook and YouTube, who's in the sanctuary listening to me. I don't know what your it is, but I know who can handle your it. I don't know what your problem is, but I know who can handle your problem. I don't know what your story is, but I know who can handle your story. I don't know what didn't work out for you, but I know who can handle it. Because one thing about God, God can wait until it is over to say, I've got to start now to show you that I'm going to do what I said I'm going to do. Because if God promised it, that settles it. That's it. Just because it didn't work out in the natural does not mean that God cannot handle it for you. So here it is. I'm done. So they, Reverend Morris, they began to praise God. Here is where I'm going to park the text here in verse 17. It said that this news about Jesus spread throughout Judea and the surrounding country. I'm done. See, what happens is, New Bethel, is that sometimes what we do is, Jesus would then do what we needed him to do in our lives. Instead of telling the world, we keep it to ourselves. But the next time that you need God to do something supernatural, the next time you need Jesus to heal, the next time you need Jesus to raise the dead. You should become an evangelist for the Lord. You need to tell everybody that God did it. You need to tell the story about how the young boy was dead and Jesus touched the bear and the boy came back to life and everybody started to praise God. You need to tell everybody that you had the tumor. They went and you went to the doctor and they said it was cancer. And by the time you went back again, the tumor disappeared. You need to tell your story that you thought that you were going to lose your life. And suddenly God healed your body and you made it out alive. You need to tell your story how you were in the car accident and it should have taken you out, but you made it out alive. You need to tell people all around in every city, in every state, in every country that it was Jesus that did it for me. And there's something about when you tell the story, because your story is a survival mechanism for somebody else. Your story will let somebody else know that if he can do it for you, he can do it for me. You need to tell your story wherever you go, wherever you go, wherever, whoever you meet. Tell your story. Here, brothers and sisters, your situation may be dead on arrival. Your situation may seem or it is over. It does not remove the fact that God can step in at the end of it and work from the beginning. The problem that we have is that we want God to step in when we expect God to step in. But what God is saying to us in this text is that I'm going to step in when I'm ready to step in, because I created time. So time cannot be wasted with me. And you may feel as if it is taking too long, but God is saying, I don't operate in chronological order. I operate in kairos. And if I operate in a different time segment, in a different time realm, there is nothing that I cannot handle or do for you. So brothers and sisters who are listening and watching me and who's in the sanctuary, God is speaking to you today to let you know that time is not of essence for him. It may be for you, but it's not for him. So number one, don't put God in the box. Actually, let God do what God does great. And we serve a God who can do it. So I don't know what your problem is. I really don't know what your storm is. I really don't know what your struggle is. I really don't know what they said and how it messed up and how you're depressed, how you're worried, how you're sad, how you're sick. But I prophesy and speak over your life today that when Jesus shows up, he's going to do what they said cannot be done. And he's going to touch what he shouldn't touch just to make a way for you. Let us pray. God, we thank you. Touch our hearts, God. We thank you for this word. We thank you, God, that you can move like only you can, that you can make a way like only you can. Bless those under the sound of my voice, oh God. God, touch them from the very crown of their head to the very sole of their feet, oh God. God, this week, allow them to have a moment that it had to be God. God, we love you. We honor you. We adore you in Jesus. Amen.
From our preacher today, Marvin Boquette, and we thank God for him. Our choir gave him the perfect setup for Dead on Arrival, because they said when Jesus says yes, nobody can say no. And that applies to all of us this morning. I know you've been trying to fix it on your own. I know you've been trying to face it on your own. But our preacher, reminded us today that God can handle it for you. And I am a witness. That's why I was standing up shouting myself. I am a witness that God can do it for you. And if you want to be an evangelist, amen, just tell the people in the room with you, they might have on their moo-moos and pajamas, but tell them that God, nobody but God, can fix it for you. And as you're telling them that, you become the evangelist that Marvin Boquette referred to in the text today. In the meantime, something you can do. The boy on the bier could do nothing until Jesus touched him. So if this word has touched you this morning, we're going to put on the screen right now, 850-296-7367. 850-296-7367. You can text there. You can text Jesus. Because nobody can fix your situation but Jesus. J-E-S-U-S. Text Jesus to that number. And our ministry will be in touch with you immediately after this worship experience. If Jesus has touched you this morning through this word, you could text to that same number, J-O-I-N, to join our New Bethel Church family. I'd love to be your pastor. We'd love to be your brothers and sisters in Christ. Again, 296-7367. That'll get you in touch with God. That'll get you in touch with the New Bethel Church. Amen. Praise God. Again, I need some more emojis for Brother Boquette and that marvelous, powerful word that God gave him to give to us today. Amen. Type in some more. Amen. Some more emojis there. Let me also, I don't believe I did this before, so let me do it now. I want to thank Brother Marcus Rose, Brother Green on drums, and then give me some emojis for our youth minister. That would be our sister Sharon Holt Harris. She has done a marvelous job with this ministry, and you can tell we got kids, and they are singing out of the depths of their heart. They are actually being raised in Christ. We are training children in the way they should go, so when they're old, they won't depart from it. Amen. So let's get some emojis for our ministry, our music ministry, as well as for our youth ministry. Amen. And while I'm at it, Sister Cynthia Hagen, she's probably at the hospital with our auntie, Sister Thelma Wills, but let me thank her for chairing the committee, the Back to Church committee, and that has Sister Sharon Zanders, as well as Sister Janice Britt, as well as Sister Rosalind Davis, and of course, Sister Sharon Holt Harris. So give me some emojis for them, the Back to Church committee. Amen. All right, we had a marvelous time in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I remember on Wednesday, our Bible study is in Mark chapter 2, chapter 2 of Mark. And then next Sunday is our celebration Sunday. So we got a bunch of birthdays and anniversaries coming up in this month of July. We'll celebrate them on next Sunday. Amen. If all hearts are clear, let me just thank our technology team, Brother Al Jones and Brother Gujap Zing. Amen. We want to give God some praise and thanks for them. They did a marvelous job today. And thank you who have joined us here in our live worship service. All right. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Benediction to you as you impart the benediction back to me. And now, may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, may the love of God, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with you now and forever. And let the church say amen. Amen. Praise God. Thank you, my brother. Good word, man.
I thought it was.
No. It's okay.
Hey, yo, 1, 2, 3. Get up, we got victory. No weapon they throw at me. You know it won't prosper now.
Yeah, just got laid off.
I'm doing good.
House ain't even paid off.
I'm doing good.
you should be afraid, but
I'm feeling good
all the time. You say
God is good.
You come on
down, down, down. Don't forget who's in control. Walls are falling down, down, down.
They call it down.
Get ready for the new Jericho. You're waiting on God. He's waiting on you.
So what you gonna do?
Hey, yo, 1, 2, 3. Get up, we got victory. No weapon may grow angry.
It won't.
You know it won't prosper now.
God, this is crazy.
Hey, yo, 1, 2, 3. Get up, we got victory. No weapon may grow angry. You know it won't prosper now. Storm's raging.
I'm doing good.
You see the world changing.
I'm doing good.
I know.
God is good.
God is good.
Down, down, down. Don't forget who's in control. Walls are falling down, down, down.
Get ready.
Get ready for the new Jericho. You're waiting on God.
You're waiting on God.
He's waiting on you.
He's waiting on you.
With all you've been through, now it's on you. So what you gonna do?
Come on.
Hey, yo, 1, 2, 3. Get up, we got victory.
Yes, sir.
The weapon may grow.
Scars, but we're still winning. Sing the anthem.
Hey, yo, 1, 2, 3. Get up, we got victory. No weapon may grow angry.
It won't.
You know it won't prosper now.
1, 2, 3.
Hey, yo, 1, 2, 3.
Yeah.
Get up, we got victory.
See them hands
no
up.
Weapon may grow
no weapon formed against
you. Know you. It won't prosper.
Won't prosper.
Now.
And all my people say,
I'm doing good.
See, the reason why you're doing good,
good.
Is because what's ahead of you is greater than
good.
All the things that were behind you. See, you gotta
I'm
understand. You gotta understand that everything was already ordained before you
good.
Got here for you to do good.
I'm
see, eyes
good.
Have not seen, ears have not heard, neither has it entered your heart. Man, God's masterful plan for his children.
I'm
that's
good.
Who you are, baby girl. You God's child. My brother,
I'm
that's who you are. You gotta understand that all things are working for you.
Good.
Let love the Lord, man. God is good.
Calm down, down, down.
waiting on you.
With all you've been through, now it's on you. So what you gonna do?
Come on!
Hey, yo, 1, 2, 3. Get up, we got victory.
Yes, sir.
Go up and make grow at me. You know it won't prosper now.
Scars, but we still winning. Sing the anthem.
Hey, yo, 1, 2, 3. Get up, we got victory. No weapon may grow at me.
It won't.
You know it won't prosper now.
1, 2, 3.
Hey, yo, 1, 2, 3.
Yeah.
Get up, we got victory.
See them hands up.
No weapon may grow
no
at me.
Formed against
you. Know
you.
It won't prosper
now. And all my people say,
I'm doing good.
See, the reason why you're doing good,
I'm doing good.
Is because what's ahead of you is greater than
good.
All the things that were behind you. See, you gotta
I'm
understand, you gotta understand that everything was already ordained before you
good.
Got here for you to do good. See,
I'm
eyes
good.
Have not seen, ears have not heard, neither has it in its across the man. God's masterful plan for his children.
I'm
and
doing
that's
good.
Who you are, baby girl. You God's child. My
I'm
brother, that's
good.
Who you are. You gotta understand that all things are working
I'm
together.
Doing good.
That's love the Lord, man. We got
got scars, but we still winners in the anthem.